We've been doing the series on fasting with a goal of just trying to capture like some broad strokes on this stuff, not really getting into like a bazillion scriptures to make the case that you need to fast, but more like trying to hit on some central themes to really capture our hearts for what God wants to do. Because I believe what's happening is that God is wanting us to actually realize that there's grace for fasting, that this is not just some duty or, you know, the Bible says we got to do it, so we do it. Or in other cases, people are, you know, saying like, we don't have to do this anymore. Well, the reality is that there's actually grace for fasting, and the Lord is energizing that right now in the most extraordinary ways, energizing it so that we can actually live a lifestyle of prayer and fasting, the fasted lifestyle. The Lord's breathing on that right now. And so we've been kind of going over some broad strokes and themes that have kind of almost worked. In my own heart, it's worked like a reboot or a reset. Fasting's one of those things that, you know, we do a lot of that here. If you're new to J-Hop, warning, there's your disclaimer ahead of time. We do a lot of fasting, and then sometimes you got to take a step back, and it's like, wait a minute, why are we doing this? You know, or like, do I really understand like the dynamics of what's going on? And I've been talking with other leaders recently, and it's like, you know, we've done 100 fasts since the last time we taught on fasting, you know? And so really our goal with this series has been to just lay just some really just practical and understandable foundational level kind of stuff regarding fasting, what the Word says about fasting, and then allow the Spirit to breathe on it so that it gets energized in our individual lives unto our corporate lives together. Some of this stuff, if you're sort of like if fasting's old hat to you, some of this may seem kind of basic. But it just, even in the basic stuff, man, I love it when the Spirit breathes on something that's really basic and it gets fresh in your heart again. It just, you know, your heart feels like just freshly tilled soil and things just start, you know, taking root and growing and sprouting. And even in my own heart, I feel like that's what's been happening these last few weeks as I've just been developing some of these ideas. But let's just kind of jump in here. I want to just go through these notes in a way that we can follow along together and hopefully not leave anything out, not miss anything. But again, I think these are, you know, this session is going to move rather quickly. It says, there's grace for the fasted lifestyle that leads us into greater desire for God and the fullness of his kingdom, which will culminate in the return of Jesus, our bridegroom God. So that was the theme, right? That was the major theme of the last session, is that Jesus is confronted with this question like, hey, John's disciples fast. Everybody's fasting. How come your guys aren't fasting? And he has this really interesting response that, you know, hey, they can't fast when the bridegroom's with them. It's the first time he identifies himself by that identity as the bridegroom. And he says they can't fast when the bridegroom's with them, but when he is taken away, then they will fast. And so that is such an important aspect of our fasting and our fasted lifestyle, is to know that it is geared towards creating desire in our hearts. Amen. This whole thing is about a man. This whole thing is about a bridegroom God, and fasting leads us into a yearning and a longing for deeper relationship with him, and then ultimately the fullness of the kingdom, which comes in its fullness in the form of Christ returning, our bridegroom returning. And so then they will fast, he says. This grace energizes wholeheartedness in the private and corporate lives of the church. The voluntary embrace, now this is one of the main themes tonight, the voluntary embrace of weakness becomes the doorway of experiencing God's power in our personal lives and to the world around us. I like this quote from Spurgeon. This is something that I've quoted so many times, but he says this: our seasons of fasting and prayer at the tabernacle have been high days indeed. Never has heaven's gate stood wider. Never have our hearts been nearer the central glory. Here's the thing, is you could have an attitude that encountering God and experiencing something like what Spurgeon is talking about here, that it's totally involuntary and that it's just a sovereign thing, that you're just in the right place at the right time and God shows up and it falls on you. or you can understand that we have a responsibility, that we have an active part. It's not a passive part, but it's an active part. And fasting is one of these active ways that we can engage our heart, that we can choose to voluntarily become weak. And in the process of voluntarily choosing to become weak, that then our lives become a landing strip for the eyes of God and for the activity of the Lord. And so suddenly when you start thinking about things, and that it kind of messes with you a little bit, it messes with the natural mind, I should say it that way, that because we don't like weakness. Nobody likes weakness. We absolutely despise weakness, right? Especially as Americans, we despise anything that looks weak, and we prize anything that looks strong. The voluntary choice to become weak, as God explains in his word, that voluntary choice and exchanging our strength for his strength, this becomes the doorway of a whole host of things that weren't possible otherwise. So let's jump in here. I want to start with four observations about Acts chapter 13. And so we've done this in each of the sessions where we've had one key passage that we've read through and we've tried to unpack a little bit and glean some truths from. This is really the central passage tonight. And so in Acts 13, verses 1 through 4, you can read along with me. It says, "Now there were in the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, a lifelong friend of Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' Then, after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus." Okay, so it's just kind of, at first reading, it's almost just like a historical note, and yet there's, I think, four things that really need to be gleaned from this that will bring us some understanding. Number one, this fasting was after Christ's coming, death, resurrection, and ascension. Now, that's important, and we've made this point in other sessions, but it bears making the point again. There is a growing popular mindset in the church that says that because of the victory of the cross and because of the indwelling work of the Holy Spirit in the new covenant, that fasting is an old way of doing things. It's an old religious system that has now passed. It's an old wineskin. And that doesn't really hold water. We're not going to unpack it tonight, but we have in other sessions that it's an argument that is shallow at best. And it really doesn't hold up against the test of other scripture. But this clearly makes the point that the apostles in the New Testament did not believe that. Would everyone agree? That this is years, sometime later, after all of that had been accomplished, after the coming of Christ, his death, his resurrection, and ascension, you have the apostles gathering together and corporately fasting. It's interesting here, and I don't really have a point to make, other than it doesn't say that they were praying and fasting, it says that they were worshiping and fasting. And the point to be made here, if there is a point, is that fasting is separate and unique from prayer. Yeah. That you can't just say prayer and fasting and just that it's all the same thing, and then, you know, maybe you go to the prayer meeting, but maybe you don't do the fast. Right? Guilty. In Scripture, fasting is separate and it is unique from the discipline of prayer. And so it's interesting here that the apostles are worshiping and fasting. This is a quote from last session's notes. I want to read it again. "There is concern in the hearts of many for the recovery of apostolic power. But how can we recover apostolic power while neglecting apostolic practice?" Interesting. You have the apostles gathered together in one place and they are fasting together. Again, here, you know, it's Matthew chapter 9. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. There was an expectation by Christ that during this time that he is not with us, Yeah, if we're going to okay, wait a minute. Jesus is inside me. He's in my heart, right? He's not gone. He's really here. Well, we understand that as Jesus, the bridegroom, that he said, it's better that I leave. It's better that I leave, and then I will send to you the helper. He sends the Holy Spirit. During this time that Christ is not with us and that we have the indwelling spirit, this is the time that he spoke of, that we would be fasting. All right, so we don't get out of it, right? Like, no sidestep in this, all right? And let's not take the cutting edge off of fasting. This happens a lot, is we read fasting in the Bible, and then we start assigning definitions to it based on what we feel like we can do or what we want to do. And so we do all kinds of fasts, don't we? We do a media fast. You know, there's been times when, particularly when we had a lot more young people here, they would do speech fasts. I really like those. You know, that people will fast anything except food. But here's what's interesting. Let's just stick with the Bible. And when you read the word fasting and you do your little word study and you look up the Greek and then you get to your concordance definition, fasting is defined as abstaining from food for a spiritual purpose. Okay, so let's not take the cutting edge off of fasting, and let's embrace it for what it is. So when we talk about fasting tonight, we're talking about not eating. Really popular, right? Really, yeah. It still amazes me that we can advertise that we're going to do a teaching session on fasting, and this many people come. You know, usually it's like, I'm going to not go to that one, because once you hear it, you're responsible. Oops. You missed your chance. All right. Point number two. This fasting was a corporate fast. Clearly, the apostles did not take Jesus' teaching on private fasting, which you can find in Matthew 6, to mean that no one can know that you are fasting. We're going to get into that in a little bit. But here we see that this was a corporate fast. And so that, we're going to find here in a little bit, that smashes this misrepresentation where people say, well, you know, if you're going to do it, then no one can know that you're doing it. Has anybody ever heard that before? That somehow you're accused of being in error because you're fasting and somebody knew. Maybe that's old hat again, but again, like it's important that we make these points so that we can understand what's going on. Clearly, the apostles knew that each other was fasting. Saul knew that Barnabas was fasting. Okay? Now, does that mean that they were in sin? The answer is no. We'll find out in a little bit. I like this quote from John Piper. He says, the critical issue is not whether people know you are fasting, but whether you want them to know, so that you can bask in their admiration. Point three. This fasting proved to be an occasion for the Holy Spirit's special guidance and direction. Clearly, there is a connection between worship, fasting, prayer, and the decisive leading of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer and the establishment of the church. Here's the question that is posed. Is there in Antioch, and we can sort of like, maybe kind of like in our mind's eye, we can join the conversation that's taking place in Antioch. The question is this: where do we go from here? Now get yourself out of Antioch and put yourself in the seat right here. Are you asking yourself the same question right now? Where do I go from here? Where do I go? Where's my life going? Where's my ministry going? God, what do you want me to do with the rest of my life? Am I the only one that asks these questions? Is it just like every other Tuesday, right? Come on, we all do this. And so when we get to these points of needing direction, again, let's not take a passive role and just waiting that this stuff is just going to like magically like zap us like lightning. No, let's understand that there is actually an active role here, an active part that we can play, an opportunity, an invitation. Okay, so I'm trying to pull the discussion of fasting out of the realm of duty and into the realm of opportunity. You understand what I'm saying? A lot of times, there's just a almost like a compulsion to fast out of guilt. You know, but, you know, I know it's in the Bible somewhere. I know it talks about it in there somewhere. And then you kind of get stuck in these cycles of guilt. And that's just not limited to fasting, right? That's limited to probably every aspect of our faith. But it's, I think it's important for us to pull fasting out of that realm of guilt, and let's put it in, like, ground it in the land of opportunity, so that when we get to these points in our life where it's like, God, I need to hear from you. It's been a while. Things are feeling kind of dry. Like I'm doing the last thing you told me to do, but I just, things just feel dry right now. I just help. This is the most honest prayer I have right now, is help. Right? That's the best prayer that we can pray sometimes, is just help. And so let's look to what's happening here in Acts 13. They're asking the same question. Where do we go from here? What's next? And so they give themselves to worshiping and fasting. What is it about fasting? Here, you know, it's like they could get together in Antioch and they could do some focus group tests with the early church. Let's get the brightest minds. Let's get some marketplace Christians up in here and let's do some boardroom meetings. All right, this is a little bit of a sting right here, okay? The church has leaned way too much on human and worldly wisdom to dictate where we go next. How is the church to develop? How are we to build? How are we to grow? How is the gospel to go forth? We lean on human understanding. We've leaned far too much on worldly wisdom. This isn't what was going on in Antioch. They get together and the thing goes vertical. Worshiping God and choosing voluntary weakness. God, we don't know the answer. They go vertical and they embrace weakness in the form of fasting. And that becomes the landing strip of a very conspicuous work of the Holy Spirit. This is fascinating to me. And it begs the question, why has the church missed this for so long? Well, that's not always been the case. There's certainly been historical occasions throughout the history of the church where the church has understood fasting. And it has been a normal part of the Christian experience. And yet, somewhere along the way, there was an idea that slipped in. And who knows where, and who knows in what way and what shape it took. But ideas have consequences, folks. That is a true statement. Ideas have consequences, good or bad. Somewhere or another, somebody got the idea and started preaching that this was not the normal Christian experience. And it fell out of favor, it fell out of practice, and then it just becomes something that is only identified as an old religious practice. And yet we look at Acts 13. Don't we gather together and we say, we want the church to be alive like she was in the book of Acts. New Testament Christianity. I want to see the book of Acts come alive again in front of my eyes and in this day and age and in my generation. We can't reclaim apostolic power without embracing apostolic practice. These guys are fasting, and this becomes the landing strip of special leading of the Holy Spirit. This fasting, point four, changed the course of history. Clearly, God chose the practice of fasting along with worship and prayer to be the launching pad for world missions and the expansion of his kingdom on earth. Listen to this. It is almost impossible to overstate the historical importance of that moment in the history of the world. Before this, a word from the Holy Spirit, there seems to have been no organized mission of the church beyond the eastern seacoast of the Mediterranean. Before this, Paul had made no missionary journeys westward to Asia Minor, Greece, Rome, or Spain. Before this, Paul had not written any of his letters, which were all a result of his missionary travels, which began here. Do you see history pivoting on this moment right here? So here we are, the church in America, represented in this room tonight. Like, do we think we can do it differently? Do we think that God's going to somehow, like, are we asking God to give us a different strategy to get this accomplished? It's not going to happen, folks. This is the strategy. Amen? Amen. I I think that's fascinating. Let's move on. Motives. Let's talk about motives. Motives matter. That is a true statement. Fasting is to be a part of our normal Christian experience. We must take careful consideration of our hearts so that we can pursue right objectives and obtain God's intended rewards. Now, we already know this would be a common statement that we'd say that, you know, we would say this about fasting, we'd say this about prayer, we would say this about numerous things, that we would say this is not a performance, right? We all know this. We know that's like bad news, right? If you're trying to do anything as a performance, you're already losing. Okay, nothing's about performance, and we know that we can't do things to earn God's approval, right? Yes, we all know this. This is common language. I feel like in the church, and yet the warning that the Lord gives us concerning fasting has to do with the motives of our heart. And so I wanted to kind of talk about this for a little bit tonight. In Matthew 6, verse 1, he says this, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven." And so the key words here, it's not to say that you can't practice righteousness and that it's not seen. Okay, it's not about that at all. It's the key words here is in order to be seen by others. And so immediately Jesus is making this about motivation. He's making this about the hidden motivations of your heart. This is really what is at stake. And so Jesus warned to not let our fasting be like the hypocrites. Okay, the hypocrites. Oh my gosh. Is there a worse word to get labeled by as a Christian, right? That's like the lowest of the low. Like to get labeled a hypocrite is like the worst thing that you could possibly be called. You can cuss me out. You can call me all kinds of names, but he called me a hypocrite. Oh, like that's like the worst, right? So what is a hypocrite? We're very familiar with the word hypocrite. We associate that with somebody who doesn't practice what they preach. That you say one thing, but you do something else. That you look a certain way, but on the inside, it's a very different picture. Hypocrite's like the worst thing that you could ever call somebody. But what is Jesus referring to in this passage? It's not that that's wrong, but let's look at the passage of Scripture here. Who were the hypocrites in this passage that Jesus was referring to? Now, I don't speak Greek, and I'm probably going to mess up the pronunciation of this, but I think it's something like Hippocrates, something like this. I don't know. The word there means actor. So when you see this word in the New Testament, that Greek word refers to the costumed performers of the theater. Now, that might give you a little bit more of a vivid picture, a little bit more understanding to say that when you practice your righteousness, don't pretend like the costumed ones in the theater are pretending. It actually gives it an added dimension, I think, that if we understand that the word hypocrite is referring to an actor, that it's not just someone that doesn't practice what they preach. It's actually, it could be understood as somebody that is pretending to be something that they're not, right? And so that's actually worse, if I could say it that way. That actually adds a layer of a dimension to it that makes it worse. And so let's look at this here. Why would it be hypocritical to fast and on the outside look like you're fasting? Doesn't the outside match the inside? By definition, why would it not be hypocritical to fast and pretend on the outside to not be fasting? You ever thought about it that way? Jesus is saying, don't be like the hypocrites. But what he's referring to is people that are fasting and then their cheeks are all sunken in. They got, you know, they got ash on their heads and they look like they're fasting, right? The outside matches the inside, presumably. Jesus says, no, don't be like them. I want you to fast, but then pretend like you're not fasting. Doesn't that sound hypocritical? Have you ever thought about it that way? Well, the answer lies in the motives. The answer lies in the motivation of your heart. Number one, Jesus is warning about having a heart that is motivated by human admiration. This isn't about fasting and looking like you're fasting. Listen, we've probably all done fasts where like it starts taking a toll, right? And it's just like, I don't know how I'm supposed to put oil on my head and make myself look any better. You know, it's like, how's that going to fix anything in the modern day, right? Like if I pour oil on my head, like everybody's going to be like, what are you doing? Right, so we got to be careful about not just trying to adhere to the details of what's said here, but understand get understanding of what Jesus is saying. Right, so like pouring oil on my head, people are gonna be like, "That guy's kind of messed up. Like, what's going on?" That's only gonna draw more attention to myself. And so Jesus is warning, not about fasting and being seen and known that you're fasting. He's warning about a heart that wants to be admired for doing something religious. Their apparent openness about fasting was deceptive of what was really in their heart. The reward that they truly sought was the praise of men. Ouch. Number two, to make matters worse, and this is what I was getting to a moment ago, to make it worse, their deceptive desire for the praise of men is hidden with a pretense of love for God. You understand, that actually makes it worse. If they were actually doing it and wearing a sign around their neck that said, I would like you all to admire me for my discipline and how I can fast better than everybody else. If they actually wore a sign that said that, no harm, no foul. Like they've stated their intentions and are aiming and probably going to hit the mark. What makes it worse is if you're doing it and secretly you want the admiration, but then you conceal it with the pretense of loving God. That actually makes it worse. And so you understand that like as Christians, boy, it's almost like a minefield in a sense that we have to take careful inventory of what's going on in our heart, right? To examine ourselves, to see if we are in the faith, because the last thing we want to do is to enter into fasting and then there be this thing about pride and all that yucky stuff that seems to be so sticky in the human heart that there would be things in there that, you know, rob us of a reward that God intends. Okay? So, and we'll talk about this in a minute, but fasting is actually, it becomes the means to actually root that stuff out. So, John Piper says this, the danger of hypocrisy is that it is so successful. It aims at the praise of men and it succeeds, but that is all. And so in point three, Jesus warned that no other reward remains for those seeking the praise of men. Fasting or anything that we're talking about, if you go into this and your hidden goal is that people would admire you for being more disciplined than everybody else or more spiritual, that you would appear more spiritual than everybody else. You understand that there is no heavenly reward that remains for that kind of a heart motivation. Your highest reward is that you might get somebody to say, wow, you're awesome. Wow, I wish I could be like you. Wow, I wish I could do it the way that you do it. And you say, oh, well, brother, you know, it's not me, it's the Lord. And we wax so spiritual sometimes. Maybe it isn't that bad in this group, but you can relate to what I'm saying, right? We can sort of like paint the picture that way so that we can understand what we want to avoid. The difference in fasting Jesus wants us to understand can be simplified like this. Being seen fasting versus fasting to be seen. Just get that phrase in the back of your head and let it stay there, okay? Fasting, being seen fasting versus fasting to be seen. So here's the charge. Fast to be seen by God. Fast to be seen by God. Fasting, as Jesus instructed, makes your life a landing strip for the eyes of God, and there is unmistakable reward for those who seek him. Matthew 6:18, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Oh my goodness, what a promise. That we can enter into fasting and we can, as best we can, God, purge me of any desire for human admiration. God, I'm in this for you. I'm seeking you, I'm pursuing you. And the Lord sees that heart. The Lord sees the heart that is pursuing him, and he promises to reward it. Guys, you can take that to the bank. Like, this isn't just like we go through these exercises. This isn't just an exercise for you to somehow learn discipline because you're so undisciplined. It's not that at all. We are posturing our lives in such a way that we would voluntarily embrace weakness, and the Lord says, oh, now I got something I can work with. Now I can show myself strong on their behalf. The eyes of the Lord are running to and fro in all the earth, searching for a heart that's loyal towards him, searching for a heart, some translations say a heart that's perfect towards him. He's looking for a heart that's just wanting him, right? And then he says, so I can show myself strong on their behalf. There is reward for this life. There is reward for that heart. Hebrews 11:6, whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Believe it. Right now, believe it. Let those words sink in tonight. If they have never sunk in before, let them sink in right now that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. Matthew 6, Jesus warned that our giving, our praying, and our fasting should not be done like the hypocrites. Right in the middle of this discussion is where Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. And in it, he reveals right goals. Okay, so here they are, Matthew 6, 9 and 10. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This becomes our litmus test, folks. This is the litmus test to examine our hearts. Jesus says, don't let your giving be like the hypocrites. Don't let your praying be like the hypocrites. Don't let your fasting be like the hypocrites. And right in the middle of it, he gives us the litmus test. And here it is, right here. Remember that having the giver is better than having the gifts. We've made that point in previous sessions, but we have to keep reminding ourselves, God, I want you more than I want all of the awesome stuff that you want to give me. It's so easy to settle, isn't it? It's so easy to get to points in life where we just settle for the gifts, and it's God's good pleasure to give you good gifts, but having the giver is better than having the gifts. Amen. These goals are the test of having a God-oriented lifestyle of fasting. One, that God's name be hallowed. Two, that God's kingdom would come. And three, that God's will would be done on earth. There's your test right there for your giving, for your praying, and your fasting. If you have goals that don't prioritize those three things, then let's examine our hearts, okay? Don't want to overcomplicate this. I think Jesus made it really easy right here for us. So let's move on. Fasting for breakthrough. You know, in Christian bookstores all around the country, you can go in and you can find an increasing number of books on the topic of fasting. 99% of them are about fasting and how it changes you, right? And rightly so. It all starts with us. It needs to start with us. What gets lost, I think, many times is how fasting affects not just you, but the world around you. And so I want to talk about fasting for breakthrough. I think this is something that is uniquely being inspired by the Holy Spirit in our generation right now. It's something that's being restored. The concept of contending prayer is growing and is finding good soil in the church. And so I want to talk about fasting first for personal breakthrough, but then we'll get into a little bit of breakthrough for the world around us. Fasting is one of the quickest ways to reveal what's truly in you and what controls you. What we trust in and what we value most are brought to the surface. If you've fasted before, what's the first thing that happens? You get hungry. and that doesn't go away. But then what happens next? You start getting irritable. You get bored. And then all these things like quickly start coming to the surface. And then if you're paying attention and not just succumbing to these things of your body screaming in hunger, screaming in boredom, all that noise that's going on, if you actually will quiet yourself and listen, what you'll find out is what's coming to the surface is all of the things that we use to dull our senses, the things that we use to occupy our time, the things that we use to numb our pain. I think it's interesting that Jesus goes after food, because probably hands down, food would be the number one for every human being on the planet, the number one go-to thing to ease our pain. What pain? Any pain. Anything going on. I feel like I need a snack. Right now. I wonder if there's ice cream in the refrigerator right now. Right? And so then something bad happens. Maybe you get some bad news at work. You get home. What do you want to do? You want to sit down. You just want to veg out and eat. And then you also start turning to these other things. You turn to TV, you turn to entertainment, you turn to all this junk that pollutes the spirit man, that pollutes our spiritual internal system, right? But food in particular, like it's a pacifier. It's that I have an emptiness inside. Something's messed up. And instead of turning to God, I want instant gratification in the form of filling my tummy so that I can feel good right now. This is how it works, folks. I don't like what happened at work today, and so I'm going to go home, and I want to immediately gratify myself. I want to immediately remove or take away that empty feeling that I've got. And so it gets into these weird things. And so fasting is the quickest way to start exposing those things, to allow them to be exposed. And so when all of those things start screaming and yelling, and then it's like, what do you do? Well, by design, it's the time to start taking inventory. God, what are we dealing with here? You're right. Like I have desired the manna more than the manna giver. I have desired entertainment more than quiet time with you. I have desired hanging out with so-and-so and talking with them instead of quiet time in your word. All of those things that we use to distract ourselves, like it's all laid out right there, and it's bare like a raw nerve, isn't it? And so that's the time to start taking inventory. Guys, this is how we start getting breakthrough in our personal lives. Richard Foster wrote a wonderful book called The Celebration of Discipline. If you haven't read it, you probably need some discipline in your life. It's classic. It's a fantastic book. Whole chapter on fasting. But he says this: more than any other discipline, fasting reveals the things that control us. Time to take inventory. John Piper says, fasting is a way of revealing to ourselves and confessing to our God what is in our hearts. Where do we find our deepest satisfaction? In God or in his gifts? And so when that stuff gets, you start voluntarily letting it get taken away, it helps you realize, oh, you're right. God, I've been hanging on to that stuff more than I've been hanging on to you. Okay. In the situation of Jesus fasting in the wilderness for 40 days, his fast is both a testing and a weapon. Fasting reveals the motivations of the heart and also strikes a blow to the enemy at the same time. When we fast, we are joining with Jesus in the declaration that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Consider this, folks, that of all the ways Jesus could have fought off Satan in the wilderness during his time of testing, the Spirit led him to fast. Of all the way, like, come on, we could probably come up with 100 different ways, seemingly better ways for Jesus to have fought off Satan in the desert. But of all the ways that he could have done it, the Spirit led him to fast. Take note of that right there. Are you guys, I wager a guess that you're dealing with something in your life right now that you cannot get the victory on. That it just seems like it just you've tried everything and it just seems like that the enemy is hounding you. Consider this, that of all the ways Jesus could have resisted Satan, the Spirit led him to fast. That's an invitation right there. That is a door of opportunity for you. Paul says, so to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Another place he says, who is weak and I am not weak? Who is made to fall and I am not indignant? If I must boast, I will boast of the things that show my weakness. The apostle is exposing something right here, and it's like we've said it 100 times, but we have to get this, folks, that his power is made perfect in our human weakness. Okay, fasting is a way to embrace that because it is against our human nature to choose to be weak. And so fasting is a gift. There's a grace for fasting so that we can voluntarily enter into weakness. Why? Because we need more discipline, because we need to like beat ourselves on the back so that we become better Christians. No, it's in the weakness that the power of God becomes conspicuously present in our lives. That's what we want. Paul is saying, no. It's like all this stuff is going on. Now I'm going to wallow in weakness so that the power of God can be made manifest. Come on. Who will accept the invitation to this kind of spiritual violence? Oh, wait a minute. What? That doesn't sound very violent, does it? To choose to be weak? Who will accept this? The invitation to this kind of spiritual violence? Everything is available to you by the Spirit, but you must actively lay hold of that. Now, you've probably heard messages on this before, but it bears repeating in this context right here. Matthew 11, verse 12, that from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence and the violent take it by force. You've probably read that, you've heard messages on it, and you still don't understand what it means to suffer violence. Understand that the word suffer there, it means to allow. The kingdom of heaven allows for you to enter into spiritual violence that you might lay hold of it, that you might lay hold of heaven. Have you thought about it that way? That in God's economy, how he's set this whole thing up, he has designed it so that it's not just going to sovereignly zap you like lightning. No, the kingdom is actually going to allow for you to actively engage and lay hold of something that otherwise you could not have gotten or experienced in your life. The kingdom of heaven allows for this. And so here we've got fasting, this quote from Mike Bickle, fasting is a call to voluntarily embrace weakness in order to experience more of God's power and presence. That is what I'm calling spiritual violence. Spiritual violence is to say, earth beings are going to make themselves weak so that they can lay hold of something spiritual and pull it down and pull it into this normal life that just keeps trudging along and you're so beat down. Woe is you. Like, stop playing the victim. Can I say that? Oh, I don't want it to sound bad, but it's got an edge on it, I know. Stop playing the victim and lay a hold of the kingdom. Yeah. Not only has God chosen fasting as a means of experiencing the power of God for personal breakthrough and the overthrow of ungodly appetites, it is also a means of aligning with God for breakthrough in the world around us. And so I like to introduce this passage when we talk about fasting affecting the world around us. Sometimes people don't understand the concept because their entire Christian experience is limited to me, myself, and I, right? Not realizing that what you're basically saying is it's all about me. Guess what? It's not all about you, right? And like the Lord is inviting us into a lifestyle of fasting so that you can realize that it's not just all about you. There's actually real things, like real massive things going on in the world around you that need to be affected by your presence and by the spiritual violence that the Lord is calling you into. And we say it this way. Let me just preface all of this before anyone is tempted to misunderstand me. It is spiritual violence in the heavens, but it's a towel on the earth. So when I talk about violence, I'm not talking about violence towards another person or against any kind of human agent, okay? We are talking about contending in the heavens, engaging in spiritual warfare, and at the same time, it's motivated by love for the individual. Always going to be motivated by love for the individual. And so we come in the opposite spirit of the hate that rages in the earth. We come with love, and we come with a towel to wash the feet. Oh, but isn't it deceptive to the kingdom of darkness? Oh, look at that weakling. Look at that weakling that can do nothing against all of the armies of hell. Oh, they don't realize that the one with the basin and the towel washing the feet of the sinner is got weapons of mass destruction in the heavenly realms. So let's get into this. Daniel chapter 10. At that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. Let me set the stage a little bit. Daniel is a man of prayer, is a man of fasting, right? We learned from Daniel 1:8, as probably a 14 or a 15-year-old man, he said, I'm not going to eat what the king's eating. I'm not going to drink what the king's drinking. I'm not going to smoke what the king's smoking, right? That's actually what he says there. It's not just that he wanted to eat vegetables. In Daniel 1, it's not just that he was looking for a special diet of fruits and vegetables. No, what he actually says there is, I'm not going to eat what the king's eating, and I'm not going to drink what the king's drinking. He was making himself consecrated as a 14-year-old. And so you now fast forward decades of that kind of a fasted lifestyle, posturing himself before the Lord and shaping the world around him. And you get to Daniel 10, and guess what had happened? He gets revelation about a great war in the future, and it's greatly troublesome to him. Why do you think Daniel got that revelation? Do you think it just lightning zapped him and he just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time? No, it's because of the lifestyle of prayer and fasting that he voluntarily chose. His life then becomes a landing strip for revelation. Make your lives a landing strip for revelation. Make yourself eligible for that kind of activity, the conspicuous activity of the Spirit. So he gets this dream, he gets a vision or whatever it is, he gets revelation about this conflict and it troubles him, and his response is to fast. He fasts for 21 days. So that's the stage here. He says, at that time I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. I ate no choice food, no meat or wine touched my lips, and I used no lotions at all until the 3 weeks were over. Then, he continued, did I miss something? Yeah. I didn't want to put a giant passage of scripture, so I'm fast forwarding. Okay, so an angel shows up, okay? While on his fast, an angel shows up and says, I have come to give you the answer. It says, then he continued, do not be afraid, Daniel. Since the first day you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard. And I have come in response to them. But the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me because I was detained there with the king of Persia. Now I have come to explain to you what will happen to your people in the future, for the vision concerns a time yet to come. Daniel has made his life a landing strip for revelation. The Lord rewards that man, gives him revelation. He then takes it back into a place of prayer and fasting, and then an angel is dispatched to give him more understanding. But then something happens. Let's get a little geography in our heads now. Where is Daniel when this is going on? He's in Babylon. Persia became Persia, right? The angel gets to the borders of Persia and he gets stopped. What in the world is going on here? Now, it says that the king of Persia detained him. Do you think that a man with a crown on his head, purple robes, was standing at the door of Persia and said, "You can't come in here"? Do you think a man could do that to an angel? No. So what's going on here? You study through these passages, you find that this is the first time in Scripture that the veil is either lifted or at least becomes translucent on this second heavens realm where there is demonic activity, where there is the movement and activity of principalities and powers. First time in Scripture that the curtain gets sort of pulled back and we are shown this picture, that you have angels dispatched from the throne of God and they get to a particular place and there is a resistance that prevents them from getting to their intended goal. Does that mess with your minds? Does that mess with you at all? And so Daniel is a man that is praying and fasting. An angel is dispatched. He's halted. But then Michael, the archangel, right? The one assigned to Israel itself, because the vision is concerning Israel. Michael comes and helps him. What did that battle look like? I don't know if there's like swords and bows and arrows and like all. I don't know if it looked like that or if it's just a weapon of words. Who knows what those battles look like, but Michael comes and helps him and he's able to break through enemy lines and come and deliver a message to a man who is fasting. It's the first time in Scripture that picture is revealed. And is it any different for us? Have you been praying for something and it just seems like nothing's getting through? Oh? Amen or oh me? How often have we found ourselves in that place where it seems like we're hitting a brass ceiling? Now, wait a minute. Didn't Jesus come and disarm the principalities and powers? Didn't he already humiliate those things? And yes, and yet they remain. Does anyone doubt that they remain? You understand that there are agreements made with human beings, positions of authority, people doing certain acts that allow this activity to persist. I would highlight here that abortion being probably the number one thing in terms of innocent bloodshed that fuels the demonic realm gives that dimension power and ability. We have to understand, guys, spiritual warfare in so many ways, it's lost on the church. In the 21st century, she doesn't get it, she doesn't understand it, she doesn't want to believe that it exists, to the extent that you'll hear some Christians say that they don't actually believe that the devil exists. It's all just it's a fable, it's make-believe. And they go on and they go through their lives pretending like this dimension doesn't exist, and yet clearly it exists. Clearly the Bible reveals this to us. And so Daniel is fasting, and so here's the picture then, is that you have angels moving, you have demons moving, and you have a man fasting. Embrace that picture. Embrace that picture right there. Beloved, you are called to move angels and demons. I love this story. I was talking with Lou Engle one time, and he was in some meeting with Mike Bickle, and there was all of these leaders representing like a wide spectrum of the church, and everyone's rubbing elbows, right? Everybody's exchanging business cards and setting up, you know, future meetings and getting emails and planning the lunches to discuss agendas and goals and alliances and partnerships. And that stuff's not bad. There's nothing wrong with that per se. But Lou told me that they're just sitting there, and he and Mike are just kind of sitting there like this, you know, watching all of this. And he said, Mike just leans over and says, these guys can have their lunches, but you and I are called to move angels and demons. It's like such an inspiring statement. You kind of have to know who you can go to lunch with and who you can go to war with. Some people you can go to lunch with and you can have a great lunch, but you need to know who you can go to war with. Beloved, you are called to move angels and demons. Your little prayer meeting, your little fast, oh, it looks so weak, it looks so pointless, and nobody even knows what's going on. You're doing it, it's, you know, either you're alone in your prayer closet, or maybe you've got like two people. You found your two that will agree with you, like Matthew 18, because nobody else would stand with you, and it looks so pitiful, so weak. You're moving angels and demons. I get so inspired when I think about these themes and these ideas that it's not make-believe. This is real, guys. This is real. You are called to engage. This is your door of opportunity to engage in spiritual violence that moves angels and demons for the sake of the world around you, I would add. Wanted to just take a couple minutes, and I'm not going to dwell on this, but I wanted to at least give you a few examples of modern historical examples of fasting for breakthrough. And I'll highlight these three, but I want to encourage you, like, go and dig on these, and you'll find other examples, but go dig on these and start reading about them. You will uncover some of the most extraordinary and supernatural outcomes. And so number one here, we have President Lincoln, an incredible president who, by declaration from the highest seat in the land, called multiple times for days of national prayer and fasting, days of humiliation. And by humiliation, that term, we understand that is a way to humble ourselves. Choosing to humble yourself instead of waiting for God to do it is always better. All right. And so what an amazing thing that as the nation is in crisis, the nation is going into war, we had a president that was calling for days of humbling ourselves before God. I don't think it's any accident. The outcome of the Civil War was that the Union was preserved and slavery was ended. When we had that kind of a man leading from the highest seat of government, I'm so inspired by this that he wasn't just putting on the game face in the White House and giving the appearance of strength. No, by declaration, he chose the low route and said, "We are going to humble ourselves." What could the outcome have been for this nation if we hadn't had a leader like that at that critical time in history? Listen, we are in similar times today, and it is imperative that as the people of God that we embrace the voluntary weakness so that the power of God can show up. Can you even imagine what the outcome might have been otherwise? Second example here, upon threat of a French invasion, the King of Britain called for a nationwide day of prayer and fasting. And so we can read about this in John Wesley's personal journals on Friday, February 6th, 1756. He said, "The fast day was a glorious day." I like that. "Such as London has scarce seen since the Restoration. Every church in the city was more than full, and a solemn seriousness sat on every face. Surely God heareth the prayer, and there will yet be a lengthening of our tranquility." He adds in a footnote to that entry that he says this humility was turned into national rejoicing, for the threatened invasion by the French was averted. Come on. Could that happen in America? Could we actually do something like what they did? Like, ask yourself that question. I'm willing to believe that if God did it and spared a nation then because the people humbled themselves and turned to the Lord in prayer and fasting. And so remember, fasting is a testing, but it's also a weapon. And so God can kill two birds with one stone. He can correct his people and at the same time do spiritual violence in the heavenlies by their obedience. And so the invasion was averted. Number three, the Battle of Britain, which was July to October of 1940. King George VI called for Sunday. Now, wait a minute, stop, time out. I love talking about the Battle of Britain. I could go on and on and on and on and on about the Battle of Britain because I've read about it so much, studied it, love reading about the activity of Rhys Howells and his students in the Bible College in Swansea during the Battle of Britain and all this stuff. I'll spare you. But here's the picture, is that Hitler, he's taken Poland, he's taken all these different nations, right? The tanks have rolled across Europe and France has fallen. And so now he turns his attention on the tiny little island of Britain and nothing stands in his way. Europe has fallen. And nothing stands in the way except 600 Royal Air Force pilots compared to 2,400 Luftwaffe pilots. They were outgunned and outnumbered. During that battle, which was extended those several months, the king called for Sunday, September 8th, to be a day of nationwide prayer and fasting. It's interesting that one of the, it wasn't the prime minister, but one of the key governmental leaders who had previously been very outspoken against calling such a day, for whatever reason, recants and goes in full, an agreement with this. And so everybody agrees. And so they call this National Day of Prayer and Fasting on September 8th. And now look at the results. Prime Minister Winston Churchill identified September 15th, a week later, it's the following Sunday, as he called it the crux of the Battle of Britain. It was the pivot point when the Battle of Britain turned, where things were escalating. And then a week after this solemn assembly and this national fast, the battle turns and things begin to look not in favor of the Nazis. Now, the ultimate outcome of that was that Hitler got this great idea to stop. When Britain was within his grasp, he stopped and changed his mind and decided to go against Moscow in the dead of winter. And he smashed against a Russian snowstorm, basically. I'm giving you these as historical examples that this stuff works. I shouldn't have to say that, but we need to hear that. God has chosen fasting as a conspicuous way to voluntarily do it his way so that his power can show up. And what could not have happened otherwise suddenly becomes, the impossible becomes possible. The destiny of nations rides on your response to that. Listen, the destiny of nations, not just your own personal world, but the destiny of our nation and the nations rides on your response to this invitation. And we must embrace it. I want to leave you with this last quote, kind of stepping back a little bit just for some personal breakthrough, just to see this as our great opportunity. This is a quote from Charles Finney, great revivalist. We love Charles Finney. He said this in his book, Power from On High. He says, "To the honor of God alone, I will say a little of my own experience in this matter. I was powerfully converted on the morning of the 10th of October. In the evening of the same day and on the morning of the following day, I received overwhelming baptisms of the Holy Ghost that went through me, as it seemed to me, body and soul. I immediately found myself endued with such power from on high that a few words dropped here and there to individuals were the means of their immediate conversion." Come on, I want that. Does anybody want that? "My words seemed to fasten like barbed arrows in the souls of men. They cut like a sword. They broke the heart like a hammer. Multitudes can attest to this. Oftentimes, a word dropped without my remembering it, would fasten conviction and often result almost in immediate conversion. Sometimes I would find myself in a great measure empty of this power. I would go out and visit and find that I made no saving impression. I would exhort and pray with the same result. I would then set apart a day for private fasting and prayer, fearing that this power had departed from me, and would inquire anxiously after the reason of this apparent emptiness. After humbling myself and crying out for help, the power would return upon me with all its freshness. This has been the experience of my life. Can we take the words of a man like Charles Finney to heart? And now examine ourselves. And I think even as I was reading that, as we've been discussing it tonight, it's provoking you. There are things about your own life, dissatisfactions and areas of challenge, areas of oppression, things where you need breakthrough. You need breakthrough so that you can become an agent of breakthrough. Stand up with me right now. The Lord is inviting you into a lifestyle of fasting. And he wants you to see it as an opportunity and not an obligation. Lord, I thank you for what you are doing in us. Lord, how you swing wide these doors of opportunity that we can enter into the fullness of what you have for us, and that we can enter into just your way of doing things, God, that aren't so complicated after all. Lord, we overcomplicate things. And Lord, you always bring us back to this. You bring us back to the simplicity of our faith. And so, Lord, we just say right now, Lord, that we want to be a people who voluntarily choose weakness as you count weakness. We want to be ones who voluntarily choose to not stand in our own human strength and try to get things done our own way, and just scream and cry unless we get it our own way. Lord, we choose the better thing tonight. We choose to come to you in weakness so that your power can be released in our lives. Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters right now that even as we embrace the life that you've called us into, Lord, that you would do what you said you would do, that you would release the reward that you have promised, that we would actually have you. That we wouldn't just have the gifts, but we would have the gift giver. Lord, we want you, but Lord, we want to see your power in our lives. Lord, we want to see power on our words again. Somebody say amen to that right there. Lord, I want to see power on my words again, God. It wouldn't be the clever words that I've thought of, but it would be the words that are just dripping with the anointing of your Holy Spirit. Lord, that we would be vessels fit for the master's use, that we would be vessels that truly you can use to break through in the earth, Lord, that a single word spoken would be like a barbed arrow that pierces the hearts of men. Lord, we long for the power that Finney knew. Lord, we long for the power that Jonathan Edwards knew. We long for the power that John Wesley knew. We long for the power that the nation of Britain knew in the darkest days. God, we cry out, God, that your church would reclaim that kind of power, God, in the darkest days of America today, God. Oh, God, that we would reclaim, God, this voluntary weakness that you've offered us and that you've called us into, Lord. We choose the way of fasting. We choose a lifestyle of fasting, Lord. So God, I just pray right now, just release